Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel, 1770 to 1831. Shyamasundardas. Hegel sought to synthesize other philosophies to arrive at the truth, and in so doing he concluded that everything that exists is reason. What is real is rational, and what is rational is real.
Srila Prabhupada. This means that he wanted to arrive at the Absolute, in whom there is no duality. That is Krishna. Krishna says, Paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya cha duskritam. Dharma samsta panartaya sambhavami yuge yuge. In order to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to re-establish the principles of religion, I appear myself millennium after millennium. Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, verse 8. He comes to earth to protect the devotees and kill the demons. Although he actually did this, we should not think that he is partial. When he killed the great demon Putana, for instance, Putana attained a position like Krishna's mother Yashoda. Because Krishna is absolute, there is no difference between his loving Yashoda and killing Putana. Whatever he does is good, be it killing or loving. The two opposites are reconciled in him. The Sanskrit word for this is Virudharta Sambandha. Shyamasundardas. Hegel saw that his predecessors had become so increasingly abstract in trying to find out the nature of substance that they had reduced substance to nothingness. Srila Prabhupada. This was due to ignorance. That is called virasa. When one cannot understand the nature or form of God through speculation, out of frustration he says, oh, there is no God. Shyamasundardas. Hegel's predecessors analyzed an object into smaller and smaller parts until they arrived at a non-entity. Srila Prabhupada. The fact is that the Absolute cannot be divided into parts. In Bhagavad Gita it is stated, Nainam chindanti shastrani, nainam dahati pavaka, na chainam kledayanti apo, na shoshayati maruta. The soul can never be cut into pieces by any weapon, nor can he be burned by fire, nor moistened by water, nor withered by the wind. Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, verse 23. It is possible to cut a material thing into pieces, but it is impossible to divide a spiritual being. A spiritual being is inexhaustible. The Mayavadis think that since the Absolute is all-pervading, he has no form, but this is incorrect. The Absolute can maintain his form as he is, and yet expand himself. Krishna says, Maya tatam idam sarvam jagad avyakta murtina. By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 4. Krishna has three features, Brahmeti, Paramatmeti, Bhagavan iti shabdyate. Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st canto, 2nd chapter, verse 11. The impersonal, localized, and impersonal. Unless we come to understand this science, it is very difficult to know the forms of the Absolute Truth. One who is incompetent, who has a poor fund of knowledge, concludes that the Absolute Truth is nirakara, void, but this is not so. Shyamasundardas. Hegel wanted to reverse the trend from abstraction to concretion. He believed that every phenomenal object has its relationship with the whole, which is reality. To understand reality, we must examine all objects and relate them to the whole and to each other. Srila Prabhupada. That is our process. The whole is Krishna, and everything is related to Krishna. Because we see everything related to Krishna, we do not artificially renounce anything, but try to utilize everything in the service of Krishna. Although the Mayavadi philosophers say that everything is Brahman, their process is neti-neti, not this, not that. In this way, the Mayavadis say that Krishna and his worship are also Maya. Our philosophy is that everything is a manifestation of Krishna's energy. The energy and the energetic are one. Narada explained, Idam hi Vishvam Bhagavan Ive Taro Yato Jigat Stana Niroda Sambhava Tad Di Svayam Veda Bhavams Tatapi Te Pradesh Matram Bhavata Pradarshitam. The Supreme Lord, Personality of Godhead, is Himself this cosmos, and still He is aloof from it. From Him only has this cosmic manifestation emanated. In Him it rests, and unto Him it enters after annihilation. Your good self knows all about this. I have given only a synopsis. Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, 5th Chapter, verse 20. The whole universe is Bhagavan, Krishna, but it appears to be separate. How it is not separate can be understood through Krishna consciousness. Ordinary men think of Krishna and non-Krishna, but there is no non-Krishna, that is illusion. Everything is Krishna. Shyamasundar Das. For Hegel, nothing can be separated from the spiritual whole, because everything is related to it. For Kant, phenomenon is the mode in which things in themselves represent themselves to the individual. Srila Prabhupada. It is explained in Bhagavad Gita that Krishna has two energies, the spiritual and the material. His spiritual energy is described as superior, and his material energy as inferior. These designations are given for our consideration, because we cannot understand otherwise. But the fact is that there is only one energy, the superior spiritual energy. When this spiritual energy is covered by ignorance, it is called material energy. The sky is naturally clear. We can normally see the sun. But when there are clouds, we cannot see it. Still, the sun is there. When we cannot see Krishna or understand Him, we experience what is called the material energy. The fact is that there is nothing material because everything is Krishna. Shyamasundar Das. Hegel says that objects themselves are the spirit expressing itself in objective nature, whereas Kant maintains that the spirit expresses itself through objects. There is a distinction made between the spirit within the object expressing itself and the spirit as the object. Srila Prabhupada. The object as it is spirit. In one sense, the sunshine is not the sun, but at the same time, it is not different from the sun, because it is the sun's heat and light. Therefore, our philosophy is achintya bheda bheda tattva, simultaneously one and different. All these objects are actually spirit, but if we have no sense of Krishna, we consider them to be material. Sometimes people criticize us for using material devices like dictaphones, typewriters, and airplanes, but we reply that these things are spiritual. If they are used for our sense gratification, they are material, but if used in relation to Krishna, they are spiritual. It is the consciousness that is important. Rupa Goswami says, Anasaktasya Vishayan Yatarham Upayunjata Nirbanda Krishna Sambande Yuktam Vairagyam Uchate Prapanchi Kataya Budya Hari Sambandi Vastuna Mamukshubi Parichyago Vairagyam Fagu Katyate. One is said to be situated in the fully renounced order of life if he lives in accordance with Krishna consciousness. He should be without attachment for sense gratification and should accept only what is necessary for the upkeep of the body. On the other hand, one who renounces things which could be used in the service of Krishna under the pretext that such things are material does not practice complete renunciation. Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu 1 Chapter 2 Verses 255 to 256. Everything has its relationship with Krishna. Rejecting everything as false is artificial renunciation. Our method is to renounce things for our sense gratification, but accept everything for Krishna's satisfaction. Krishna says, Mam cha yo vyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate sa gunan samati yaitan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. One who engages in full devotional service, who does not fall down in any circumstances, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahman. Bhagavad Gita, 14th chapter, verse 26. As soon as we engage fully in devotional service, we are immediately spiritualized. When we are in devotional service, the spiritual quality of everything is revived. In truth, everything is spirit, but it is covered by our material consciousness, just as gold may be covered by mud. If we cleanse the heart, we immediately understand that things are spiritual. In material consciousness, we conceive of ourselves as Americans, Indians, men, women, and so on. But when we come to our spiritual consciousness, we realize, I am Krishna's servant. Thus, we understand that we are spiritual. These material conceptions are like dreams. When we are dreaming, we may think that we are this or that, or that we are performing so many acts. But when we awake, we understand our real identity. Because we are part and parcel of Krishna, we have no duty other than to serve Krishna. When this consciousness comes, everything is spiritual. Hayagrivadas. In Philosophy of Religion, Hegel writes, God is a living God who is acting and working. Religion is a product of the divine spirit. It is not a discovery of man, but a work of divine operation and creation in him, God. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, it is very important to understand that a man cannot manufacture religion. We define religion as the orders given by God, as stated in Bhagavad Gita. Yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharata abhyutanam adharmasya tadatmanam srijam yaham paritranaya sadunam vinashaya chaduskritam dharma samsta panartaya sambhavami yuge yuge. Whenever and wherever there is a decline in religious practice, O descendant of Bharat, and a predominant rise of irreligion, at that time I descend myself. In order to deliver the pious and to annihilate the miscreants, as well as to reestablish the principles of religion, I appear myself millennium after millennium. Bhagavad Gita chapter 4 verses 7 through 8. This is religion. Religion rests on the orders of Krishna, or God, and if you strictly follow Krishna's instructions, you are religious, pious, and transcendental. If you defy Krishna and manufacture your own religion, you are asuric, demoniac. Shyamasundardas. According to Plato's and Kant's philosophy, these temporary objects are representations of an ideal. This table, for instance, represents or expresses the ideal table, but it is not the ideal itself. Srila Prabhupada. We also say that this material world is a perverted reflection of the spiritual world, it is like a mirage. Sridhar Swami said that it is due to the actuality of the spiritual world that this illusory world appears to be true. Because there is in reality a real table, we can perceive this table. Although the entire material creation is but a perverted reflection of the reality, people are enamored by it. People take this to be a real table, a real body, a real society, real happiness, and so on. Shyamasundardas. Hegel would say that these are genuine externalizations of the reality, that this is a real table, and that these are real objects. It is not that they are images of the real, but that they themselves are real. Srila Prabhupada. What does he mean by real? For us, reality means that which does and will exist. If this is not the case, it is not real. Nasato vijite bhavo, na bhavo vijite sata. Ubayor api drishto nitas, tvi anayos tattva darshibi. Those who are seers of the truth have concluded that of the non-existent there is no endurance, and of the existent there is no cessation. This seers have concluded by studying the nature of both. Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, verse 16. Reality refers to that which exists eternally. This table exists temporarily, therefore it cannot be classified as reality. It is like a dream or hallucination, because it is temporary. We cannot say that a dream is real, although in a dream, everything appears to be real. Shyamasundardas. But isn't there a table on the spiritual platform, an absolute table? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, in Krishna's abode, there are tables, chairs, all kinds of furniture, eternally existing. But these things are manifest here only temporarily. Shyamasundardas. Which is correct? Does the spirit express itself in this object, or is it that the spirit is this object? Srila Prabhupada. The object is an expression of the spiritual energy. Whatever is manifest is the energy of Krishna, but one energy is eternal and another energy is temporary. That which is manifest temporarily is material, and that which is manifest eternally is spiritual. Shyamasundardas. So in that sense, can you say that this table is made of spirit, but at the same time is not? Srila Prabhupada. Originally, it is made of spirit in the sense that Krishna is the whole spirit. And because it is Krishna's energy, it is factually Krishna. You may make various images out of clay. You may mold pots and bricks, and they may be manifest temporarily as pots and bricks. But originally, they are clay. And when they are destroyed, they will again emerge into their original condition. There are three conditions, the formless condition, the form, and again, emerging into the formless. In Srimad Bhagavatam, Krishna tells Lord Brahma, Nanyad yat sad asat param, pachad aham yat etat cha, yova shishyeta sosmi aham. It is I, the personality of Godhead, who was existing before the creation when there was nothing but myself. Nor was there the material nature, the cause of this creation. That which you see now is also I, the personality of Godhead. And after annihilation, what remains will also be I, the personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam, 2nd Canto, Chapter 9, Verse 33. So Krishna existed in the beginning of the creation. He maintains the creation, and when the creation is annihilated, he continues to exist. Shyamasundardas. Therefore, the Mayavadis would say that this table is Maya? Srila Prabhupada. They say that it is Maya, but we say that it is temporary. Shyamasundardas. But there is also a spiritual world full of form? Srila Prabhupada, yes, but the Mayavadis do not know of this. What is the source of these forms? The Vedanta Sutra states, Janmadi Asya. Form comes from the original source. These forms that we see here are not eternal forms. They are imitations, perverted reflections of eternal forms. A reflection is not eternal. Shyamasundardas. Haeckel says that these forms are not eternal, but that the interaction of forms is an eternal process. Srila Prabhupada. A mirage is neither factual nor eternal, but there is factual and eternal water. Otherwise, how could anyone have a conception of water? Shyamasundardas. But if the universe is rational and everything has a purpose, this temporary form is also spiritual because it has some kind of purpose. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we are utilizing everything for Krishna's purpose. Our proposal is to make the best use of a bad bargain. Shyamasundardas. But what if a person doesn't know the purpose? Is the object still spiritual? Srila Prabhupada. Yes. Whether a person knows or does not know, fact is fact. We have only to receive knowledge from one who knows. All objects are spiritual. But one who does not have knowledge does not have the eyes to see that spirituality. Shyamasundardas. Then is God's plan unfolding itself everywhere, whether we understand it or not? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, he reveals himself in Bhagavad Gita, and he sends his representative to unfold this plan. The essence of things is spiritual, but our imperfect vision makes things material. Shyamasundardas. Haeckel believes that everything has a purpose, that the whole universe is rational, and that it is unfolding under the direction of reason, the spirit of the Absolute. Srila Prabhupada. Certainly. Only rascals think that there is no purpose in life, that everything is a result of chance. Shyamasundardas. For Haeckel, in order to understand this reality, we must examine the interrelationships of things. Srila Prabhupada. We are also teaching that the origin of everything is Krishna, and Krishna's energetic expansions constitute everything. Parasya Brahmana Sakshaj Jata Vedo Si Havyavat Devanam Puru Sanganam Yagena Purusham Yajeti. O Fire God, you are a part of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Hari, and you carry to him all the offerings of sacrifices. Therefore, we request you to offer to him the sacrificial ingredients we are offering the demigods. For the Lord is the real enjoyer. Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th Canto, Chapter 20, Verse 17. Physical existence is heat and light, and these energies emanate from Krishna, the original light. Everything material and spiritual is composed of heat and light. One who has eyes to see that which is spiritual can see. Shyamasundardas. Haeckel attempted to establish the relationship between concrete realities, isolated facts, or moments, as he calls them, can never constitute the truth because the truth is the whole, an integrated unity that is organic and dynamic. Srila Prabhupada. Just by analyzing ourselves, we can understand that I, the soul, am existing and that my bodily features are changing. When things change, we call them material. The spirit soul exists in all conditions, and that is the difference between spirit and matter. Shyamasundardas. Moments, factors in the organic whole, progress in an evolutionary way, according to the course set by reason, which Haeckel calls the Weltgeist, the world spirit. Srila Prabhupada. That world spirit is a person, Unless you accept a personal God, there is no question of reason. The reason guiding everything in the universe is explained in Bhagavad Gita. Mayadhyakshena Prakriti. This material nature is working under my direction. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 10. Direction means reason. Therefore, as soon as you speak of reason, you must accept the Supreme Person who is directing everything according to his supreme reason. Shyamasundara Das. Would you say that all world events are expressions of this world spirit, or world reason unfolding itself? If so, what is the ultimate purpose of that plan? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, there is a plan. Otherwise, why would Krishna say adhyakshena, superintendence? There is a plan, direction, and also reason. The living entities are part and parcel of Krishna, and somehow or other, they wanted to enjoy this material world. Therefore, Krishna has given them a chance, just as a father gives a chance to his small children to play. Krishna says, Saravasya chaham riddhi sannivishto mata smritir jnanam apoyanam cha. I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. Bhagavad Gita, chapter 15, verse 15. The whole plan is that Krishna gives the living entity freedom to play, and then again come home. He says, all right, you want to play, but when you are tired of all this nonsense, give it up and come back to me. This world is like a playground for conditioned souls, and the body is like a small field, chaitra, on which the living entity wants to play. Idam shariram kanteya, kshetram iti abhidhyate, etad yo veti tam prahu, kshetragya iti tad vida. This body, O son of Kunti, is called the field, and one who knows this body is called the knower of the field. Bhagavad Gita, 13th chapter, verse 2. The material body is nothing but a field of action, and Krishna says, all right, utilize this field and enjoy yourself. When you are exhausted playing in this field, you can have another. In this way, the living entity is changing bodies, changing different fields of action. Shyamasundara Das. Is this play aimless, or is there gradual evolution? Srila Prabhupada. There is a goal. Krishna gives us knowledge, and the Vedas are also there. Krishna says, this play is not very healthy. Therefore, I request that you give it up and come back to me. This is the plan. Shyamasundara Das. According to the Hegelian dialectic, being and nothing are empty abstractions. Being is the thesis, nothing is the antithesis, and the synthesis is change, becoming. Srila Prabhupada. The question of becoming arises because we are now in this awkward, marginal position. Although I am eternal, I have been trapped by something mortal. Consequently, I am changing my position, and this is called transmigration. When I cease transmigrating, I attain my own true being, which is eternal. Shyamasundara Das. Hegel believes that when the dialectic is exhausted, it reveals the whole, unified absolute truth. But since nature is constantly unfolding, guided by the world spirit, the dialectic process continues indefinitely. Srila Prabhupada. In other words, you cannot find out the ultimate synthesis. Therefore, you have to receive information from Shastra. The thesis is that the soul within the body is immortal, and the antithesis is that the body is mortal. The liberation of the soul from the body is the synthesis. When we understand that we are in an awkward position within this material world, we strive for liberation. Unless we understand that we are entrapped, there is no question of liberation. Shyamasundara Das. Hegel understood the absolute truth to be always changing and yet always permanent. Srila Prabhupada, the absolute does not change. Even we are permanent. Being part and parcel of Krishna, we are permanent even though we are moving about in these material bodies. Although Krishna manifests himself in various expansions, he remains the same. Shyamasundara Das. Hegel saw the absolute truth unfolding itself in history, biology, sociology, and other sciences. Srila Prabhupada. Krishna is in the center of everything, and everything is emanating from Krishna. Temporary manifestations come from Krishna and then return to Krishna. History is simply repetition. Shyamasundara Das. For Hegel, God or the Absolute Truth manifests in three forms: the idea in itself, the idea for itself, and the idea in and for itself. Srila Prabhupada. This means that he is trying to create God. For him, God is an idea. Is this his philosophy? The Mayavadis also believe that actually there is no God, that God is created by man's imagination, that he is impersonal or dead. So many people are busy creating God. Vivekananda, for instance, claimed Ramakrishna to be God. Hayagriva Das. In maintaining that God's essence is thought and thinking, despite whatever images God may assume, Hegel is basically an impersonalist. He writes, God is in his very essence thought and thinking. However, his image and configuration be determined otherwise. Srila Prabhupada. If God is absolute, his image is also absolute, and also God. If God is absolute, his words are also absolute and are non-different from him. The image of God worshipped in the temple is God himself, because God is absolute. God says that earth, water, fire, and everything else is his energy. And even if we think that the image of God is made of stone, we must acknowledge that the stone is God's energy. Even though a copper wire may not be electricity, it carries electricity. And if you touch it, you will understand it to be non-different from electricity. You may think materially that an object is different from God, but spiritually everything is God. Archye Vishnu Shiladir Gurushu Naramatir Vaishnave Jati Buddhi. One who considers the Archamurti, or worshipable deity of Lord Vishnu, to be stone, the spiritual master to be an ordinary human being, and a Vaishnav to belong to a particular caste or creed, is possessed of hellish intelligence and is doomed. Padma Purana. We should not look upon the deity as something material, as stone, Shila. As soon as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu saw the Jagannath deity, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu immediately fainted. In order to realize God's omnipresence, we must be trained to follow God's instructions. It appears that Hegel is theorizing that God is an idea, but God is substance. Shyamasundara Das. And what do you mean by substance? Srila Prabhupada. Substance is something concrete. You may form an idea of a golden mountain, but there is a difference between that idea and the golden mountain itself. When you actually see and touch a golden mountain, it is a fact. That fact is substance. Shyamasundara Das. For Hegel, there is idea, substance, and the synthesis, which is spirit. Srila Prabhupada. According to our philosophy, spirit is realized in three phases: Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan. Realizing Brahman is like realizing the sunshine, which is impersonal. Realizing Paramatma is like realizing the sun disk itself, which is localized. However, if we have the capacity to enter the sun, we will see the sun god himself, and this may be compared to Bhagavan realization, the personal feature of God. Once we realize the personal feature, we automatically understand the impersonal and localized features. According to Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, verse 40, the impersonal Brahmajyoti is the bodily rays of Krishna. Similarly, Paramatma is the localized feature of Krishna, sitting in everyone's heart. The sun is one, not many, but it is capable of being reflected in countless water pots. One who sees the sun's reflections in the pots may think, "Oh, there are millions of suns." One who has seen only the sunshine thinks of the sun impersonally. But when one knows the sun god, he has attained personal realization. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is a person, Sri Krishna. When you have a clear conception of God, you understand this. You cannot make God into an idea. Ideas arise because there is substance. Shyamasundar Das. Hegel uses the word idea to refer to rational form, which precedes material or physical form. Srila Prabhupada. It is stated in Brahma Samhita that Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, has form, vigraha. But what kind of form is this? Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchitananda Vigraha. Krishna is the Supreme Godhead, and he has an eternal, blissful, spiritual body. Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, verse 1. Sat means eternal. Presently we have bodies which are asat, temporary. But Krishna's body is different from ours. The word ananda means blissful. Krishna is always blissful. And chit means knowledge. Krishna knows everything. In this way he is different from us. He is not an idea, but substance itself. Shyamasundar Das. When we were discussing Plato, you agreed that the ideal precedes the physical representation. Srila Prabhupada. From the Shastras, we learned that there is a spiritual world, and that this material world is a perverted reflection of that world. From the Shastras, we also understand that the houses in the spiritual world are made of Chintamani. Chintamani Prakara Sadmasu. In this world, we have no experience of Chintamani, philosopher's stone, a stone that turns other metals to gold. But we may have some idea by hearing from authorities. It is not that we manufacture or think up the spiritual world. In other words, we have ideas of substances which we may not have seen. Shyamasundar Das. For Hegel, spirit generates ideas and actualizes them. Srila Prabhupada. We say that everything comes from Krishna. Why just ideas and substances? Why this or that? Why so many distinctions? Everything comes from him. Unless there is substance in the spiritual world, nothing could exist. In the final analysis, we have to accept the fact that everything is emanating from the substance. Janmadi asya. All ideas can be traced back to the original substance, which is Krishna. Therefore, Krishna says, everything is emanating from me. If you attain Krishna, therefore, you attain the ultimate substance. If you understand God, you understand everything. Shyamasundar Das. Then you would say that form precedes idea, not that idea precedes form? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, form precedes idea. Krishna says, Sarvasya chaham hridi sani vishdo mata smritir gyanam apoanam cha. I am seated in everyone's heart, and from me come remembrance, knowledge, and forgetfulness. Bhagavad Gita, 15th chapter, verse 15. As far as man is concerned, he cannot invent anything. He can only discover things that are already there. Shyamasundar Das. Hegel sees idea and substance opposing one another as thesis and antithesis. Spirit is the synthesis containing both. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we agree. Viru Dharta Sambandana. contradictory things are adjusted in Krishna. Therefore, we say that Krishna is inconceivable. He is simultaneously one with and different from his creation. Since it is impossible to conceive of these things in the material world, they are called inconceivable. Shyamasundara Das. Then, if we can conceive of something, must it exist somewhere? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, it is a fact that you cannot conceive of anything that does not have existence. In this material world, we understand that 1 plus 1 equals 2, and that 1 minus 1 equals 0. But in the spiritual world, this law does not apply. There, 1 plus 1 equals 1, and 1 minus 1 equals 1. Shyamasundara Das. But what of the idea that God is evil? Can I conceive of this? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, God is also evil, but not according to our understanding. God is absolute, and evil and good are reconciled in him. We cannot say that because we think of God as evil, that he is evil. Rather, we say that he is all good because he is absolute. Shyamasundara Das. What of the idea that God does not exist? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, it is a fact that he does not exist as far as rascals are concerned. Since a rascal cannot understand God, God does not exist for him. Shyamasundara Das. What of the idea that I am God? Srila Prabhupada. That is also a fact because you are part and parcel of God. You may say, I am an American, and President Nixon can also say, I am an American. But this does not mean that you are President Nixon. It is madness to claim such a thing. Hayagriva Das. Concerning God and man, Hegel writes, God is only God insofar as he knows himself. His self-knowledge is, moreover, his consciousness of himself in man, and man's knowledge of God, a knowledge that extends itself into the self-knowledge of man in God. Srila Prabhupada. If he accepts the existence of God in man, why does he not agree to receive knowledge of God from God himself? Why speculate? To possess knowledge of God, man had best take advantage from God himself. Yet Hegel is opposed to receiving knowledge or instructions from an exterior source. It stands to reason that if you want to know about me and my nature, you had best take knowledge from me, personally, instead of speculating. In Bhagavad Gita, God explains himself, and if we accept this knowledge which is given by God, our knowledge of God will be perfect. Why waste time speculating? Hayagriva Das. Perhaps without speculation, a philosopher wouldn't be able to write so many books. Srila Prabhupada. No, when you have perfect knowledge, you can write perfectly. Without perfect knowledge, your writing will simply be nonsensical. If there is any meaning in our books, it is there because we are not speculating about God, but are understanding God from God himself. This is the parampara system. According to Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Saksha Dharitvena Samasta Shastra, Sri Gurvastika 7, all scriptures accept the Guru, the spiritual master, as the Supreme Lord himself, because he does not concoct anything. He is the servant of God, and his knowledge is given by God. If Hegel accepts the fact that he is a man and that God exists, he should logically receive knowledge about God from God himself. Shyamasundara Das. For Hegel, the absolute idea, the idea in and for itself, manifests itself in the objective mind in the form of laws, morality, and social ethics, and the free will develops in these areas. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, that is the field of the free will. As soon as we accept a controller, all these are manifest. Laws will come, morality will come, and social ethics will come. Since atheists do not accept the controller, they act immorally. Unless we have a platform on which to execute the free will, there is no meaning to free will. There must be some law, some system of morality. At the same time, Krishna told Arjuna to do whatever he decides. Bhagavad Gita 18th chapter verse 63. That is free will. After explaining Bhagavad Gita to him, Krishna told him that the choice was his. Hayagrivadas. Hegel placed a great deal of emphasis on human freedom. He accused the Orientals, specifically the Hindus, of not knowing that the spirit is free in itself, or that man is free in himself. Because they do not know it, they are not free. Srila Prabhupada. He speaks of human freedom, but he is subjected to birth, old age, disease, and death. Where is his freedom when he dies? Hayagrivadas. Hegel writes that only the Germanic nations have in and through Christianity achieved the consciousness that man qua man is free, and that freedom of the spirit constitutes his very nature. Srila Prabhupada. According to the Christian religion, a man has the freedom either to go to heaven or to hell. That is, he has the freedom to make a choice. However, if he goes to hell, where is his freedom? Every citizen has the freedom either to live as a free citizen or to go to jail. But if one goes to jail, where is the freedom? His freedom is dependent on someone else who gives him a chance to either remain free or go to prison. Our freedom is relative, and God is the supreme absolute controller. It is God who gives a living entity the freedom to make his choice. The living entity is never completely free, as God is. Hayagrivadas. Hegel criticized Hinduism as a theocracy in which man is handed laws from an exterior God. For Hegel, this is a blind following of an exterior will, a following not confirmed within the individual himself. He believed that man could best attain God through the exercise of his own free will. Srila Prabhupada. If this is the case, why can't animals attain God? They're also given a free will. Hayagrivadas. He claims that animals have no will. Srila Prabhupada. If they have no will, why do they go different directions? Hayagrivadas. Hegel even went further to say, in the philosophy of right and law, that animals have no right to life because they have no will. Srila Prabhupada. First of all, you must determine what is life. Animals are eating, sleeping, defending, and mating just as we are. A small ant has all the life symptoms that we have. Who is to say that a man has more right to live than an ant? The life symptoms are the same. Shyamasundardas. For Hegel, the individual conscience evaluates itself and sets its own standard of morality. Srila Prabhupada. Our morality is not like that because we accept morality from a higher authority. Our morality is standardized. Krishna says, "Abandon all varieties of religion and just surrender unto me." Bhagavad Gita 18th chapter verse 66. This is the morality we accept. The laws of man are imperfect, but God's are perfect. Why should we accept the imperfect advice of other men? Shyamasundardas. Hegel sees the subjective mind dealing with inner experiences, the objective mind with exterior, and the absolute mind dealing with both and uniting them. Srila Prabhupada. That is correct. Anyone can understand that this is the case with the Absolute. Shyamasundardas. The Absolute expresses itself in three forms: art, religion, and philosophy. In art, the Absolute assumes the form we call beauty. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we define God as all beautiful. Shyamasundardas. Hegel considers religion to be like an art form. whereas philosophy conceives or thinks of the absolute, religion represents or pictures it. Srila Prabhupada. Without a philosophical basis, religion is simply sentiment. Shyamasundardas. He maintains that art is an expression of spirit. Srila Prabhupada. Well, everything is an expression of spirit. How is that a definition of art? Shyamasundardas. What about a tree? Can we say that a tree is the artful display of the absolute? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, a tree is also a form of art. Krishna is the supreme artist also. Shyamasundardas. The absolute mind expresses itself through religion, which presents the absolute truth as representations in our consciousness. Srila Prabhupada. Religion means accepting God. If he thinks that religion is a mere representation in our consciousness, he has no clear idea of religion. Abiding by the laws of God is religion. Shyamasundardas. For Hegel, the highest form in which the absolute manifests itself is philosophy, which is the synthesis of art and religion. Srila Prabhupada. Philosophy also means obeying the orders of God. Anything else is dry speculation. God says, "Thou shalt not kill." If we are religious, we stop killing. However, if we understand why we should not kill, we are philosophic. There are many people who accept Krishna as God, but an advanced devotee understands Krishna, and therefore he is very dear to Krishna. But highest of all is love of Krishna. The gopis were not philosophers, but they loved Krishna without ulterior consideration. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself expressed this love of Krishna. Shyamasundardas. Once you said that even higher than philosophy is the practice of philosophy. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, the gopis were practicing philosophy because they were loving Krishna. Moreover, they were enjoying the results of philosophy. Hayagrivadas. Since the body is the soul's instrument, Hegel considered injury to the body to be injury to the person himself. In the philosophy of right and law, he says, it is but vain sophistry that says that the real person, the soul, cannot be injured by maltreatment offered to one's body. Violence done to the body is really done to me. Srila Prabhupada. Then what is the justification for killing animals? Hayagrivadas. He would say that a person can possess his body because he can put his will into it. Animals, however, have no right to life because they do not put their will into the possession of their bodies. Srila Prabhupada. If that is the case, why do animals object when you kill them? What kind of philosophy is he expounding? Hayagrivadas. He says that mankind has the right of absolute proprietorship. He writes, a thing belongs to the accidental first comer who gets it, because a second comer cannot take possession of what is already the property of another. Srila Prabhupada. In other words, might makes right. But consider, how would you take ownership of gold? First of all, you must hunt out gold that has no proprietor. You must inquire who the actual proprietor of the gold is. You may claim first proprietorship, but the gold was there in the first place. Whose property is it? Who made the gold and kept it before you came along? Hayagrivadas. Hegel would say that the first comer is not legal owner by virtue of his being the first comer, but because he has free will. That is, it is mine because I put my will into it. Srila Prabhupada. That's all right, but someone made the gold and kept it before you went to capture it. Since this was the case, by willing it to be yours or by taking it, you become a common thief, not a philosopher. Our claim to proprietorship is false because we are neither the creators nor maintainers of property. Shyamasundar Das. As far as action is concerned, activity in accordance with conscience is proper activity for Hegel. Srila Prabhupada. A thief becomes accustomed to stealing, and therefore his conscience says, yes, I must steal, it is my right. The conscience of a murderer tells him to murder. Originally, the Bible said, thou shalt not kill. But people have created a conscience by which they can think, yes, killing is all right. Conscience is created by association. If our association is good, we create a good conscience. And if it is bad, we create a bad conscience. There is no absolute standard for the conscience. Conscience means discriminating power. Shyamasundar Das. He maintains that there is an absolute conscience, which is pure rationality. Srila Prabhupada. Pure rationality is Krishna consciousness. Unless we come to that platform, so-called conscience and philosophy have no value. Shyamasundar Das. Hegel believes that punishment for crime is justified because it vindicates justice and restores rights. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, therefore, when one kills an animal, he should be prepared to be killed. That is justice. According to the Manusamhita, it is justice to hang a murderer. It is unjust to save him, because if he is not hanged in this life, he escapes justice and has to suffer severely in the next. In order to be saved from many troubles in the next life, the murderer should be killed. The king who is hanging him is doing him justice and rendering a life for a life. But according to Vedic philosophy, if one kills an animal, he should also be prepared to be killed. A sane man would not run such a risk. Shyamasundar Das. If I observe in nature that living entities are killing one another to eat, it only seems rational that I should be able to eat animals. Srila Prabhupada. Well, Vedic philosophy also accepts the fact that one living being is food for another. Ahastani sahastanam, apadani chatushpadam, falguni tatra mahatam, jivo jivasya jivanam. Those who are devoid of hands are prey for those who have hands. Those devoid of legs are prey for the four-legged. The weak are the subsistence of the strong. And the general rule holds that one living being is food for another. Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, 13th Chapter, verse 47. But this does not mean that you should kill your son and eat him. There must be discrimination. It is nature's law that we have to eat other living beings in order to exist. Therefore, we can eat fruit and vegetables. We can take these without killing the trees and plants. But if we eat animals, we have to kill them. The point is that we should act intelligently to make the best of a bad bargain. We take fruits, grains, vegetables, and milk products and offer them to Krishna. If there is any responsibility, it is Krishna's. After offering the food to Krishna, we then accept it as prasadam. Yajna shishtashina santo muchante sarva kilbishai. Bunjite te tviyakam papa, ye pachanti atma karanat. The devotees of the Lord are released from all kinds of sins because they eat food which is offered first for sacrifice. Others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment verily eat only sin. Bhagavad Gita, 3rd chapter, verse 13. If you cook for yourself, you have to take all the responsibility for your sinful activity, even if you are a vegetarian. We therefore take the remnants of jagya sacrifice, and in this way we perform jagya. It is not that we prepare food directly for our own consumption. Hayagriva Das. Hegel was a strong believer in the right of man to choose his own occupation. He writes, in the Platonic state, subjective freedom was of no account, since the government assigned to each individual his occupation. In many Oriental states, this assignment results from birth. The subjective choice, which ought to be respected, requires free choice by individuals. Srila Prabhupada. The occupations are already given, but you have the freedom to select one of them. Krishna states in Bhagavad Gita, Chatur Varnyam Maya Srishtam Guna Karma Vibhagasha. According to the three modes of material nature and the work ascribed to them, the four divisions of human society were created by me. Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, verse 13. One can make his selection according to his qualifications. A man can become an engineer, for instance, when he becomes qualified to do the work. The words used are guna karma. The work is determined by one's qualities, not by birth. It is not that one automatically becomes a Brahmin because he is born in a Brahmin family. Rather, he has a better chance of being trained as a Brahmin if his father is a Brahmin, just as one stands a better chance of being trained as a musician or a cobbler if those are his father's occupations. However, it is not that a cobbler cannot become a Brahmin. If he acquires the qualifications, he should be considered a Brahmin. Nor is it that a Brahmin's son necessarily becomes a Brahmin without qualification. The point is that we must first attain the qualifications and then work accordingly. Shyamasundardas. Concerning the state, Hegel writes, the state is the realization of the ethical ideal. We must therefore worship the state as the manifestation of the divine on earth. Srila Prabhupada. First, we have to understand the duty of the state. If it is accepted that the state is the representative of God, the state's first business is to make its citizens God-conscious. Any state that neglects this duty should be immediately rejected as unqualified. The leader may either be a president or a king, it doesn't matter. In Vedic culture, the king is called Naradev, God in human form, and he is offered respect in that way. A king is respected because he is considered God's representative. We also present ourselves as Krishna's representative. And what is our duty? To lift others to God consciousness. Shyamasundardas. Hegel recommended a constitutional monarch to be the executor for the world spirit. But he was so vague that even Hitler could utilize his political philosophy to his ends. Srila Prabhupada. First of all, the monarch has to be educated. Hitler came not as a king, but a usurper. Nowadays, any rascal can assume power. Because the leaders are not trained to protect the citizens, the whole world is in trouble. A leader can whimsically declare war and involve all the citizens. In Vedic monarchy, there is a kind of disciplic succession wherein the king trains his son, and in this way he can govern properly. Shyamasundardas. According to Hegel, in a well-ordered monarchy, only the law has objective power. The king is simply the servant of the law. Srila Prabhupada. That is constitutional monarchy. A show bottle king. If a king is God-conscious and is trained up properly and has complete power, he is a Rajarshi. In Bhagavad Gita, it is mentioned that the ancient saintly kings had understood this science of Krishna consciousness. Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, verse 2. They were not ordinary men. The king was supposed to have been saintly. He had to understand the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita and introduce an educational system so that the people could understand the science of God. That is the very first duty of the state and king. It is also stated in Srimad Bhagavatam that one should not become a head of state, a father, a guru, if he cannot save his wards from the imminent danger of death. Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, 5th chapter, verse 18. We are now entangled in repeated birth and death, and it is the state's duty to promote liberation from this cycle. Shyamasundara Das. Hegel considers it the purpose of the state and king to apply the moral law. Srila Prabhupada. That is the duty of the king, but the leaders in modern democratic states are concerned only with exacting taxes. It is stated in the Shastras that if the leaders keep the citizens morally blind and exact taxes from them, the leaders will go to ruination. Because they are sinfully earning money, they suffer in this life and the next. Similarly, when the guru accepts disciples, he takes the responsibility for their sinful reactions. When a king levies taxes, he takes a share of the sinful reactions of the citizens. If the citizens are pious, both the king and the citizens will profit. If not, if it is a case of the blind leading the blind, they will lead one another to hell. The main point is that the head of state should be a representative of God, and his duty should be to train citizens to become God-conscious. Shyamasundara Das. Hegel also maintains that each state should be independent in itself and not be subordinate to other states. Srila Prabhupada. Every state may be independent in an individual capacity, but every state is dependent on God's order. If the states are representatives of God, how can they be independent? Shyamasundara Das. He claims that there is no higher body to judge the states, and that their differences must be settled by war. Srila Prabhupada. There is a higher authority if there is religion, philosophy, and learned Brahmins. Shyamasundara Das. He can see no potential world authority. Srila Prabhupada. That is because the Vedic Varnashram Dharma has been rejected. According to that system, the Brahminical culture was superior to the Kshatriya culture. The Brahmins are to advise the kings. Because people have rejected the Vedic system, they say that there is no authority. Shyamasundara Das. Well, there was no judge to settle the dispute between Ram and Ravana, and that resulted in war. Srila Prabhupada. The judge was Lord Ramachandra himself. He is God. Shyamasundara Das. In a sense, Hegel glorifies war. War protects the people from the corruption which an everlasting peace would bring upon them, he says. Srila Prabhupada. At the conclusion of the Battle of Kurukshetra, Sanjaya points out that wherever there is Krishna, there will be victory. Bhagavad Gita 18th chapter verse 78. If there is a war, the party that is God-conscious will be victorious. If neither side is God-conscious, it is a demonic war. It is not justified. It is just like a cat and dog fight. If we fight, we should fight on behalf of the Supreme God. That is called Dharma Yuddha. Arjuna did not want to fight, but Krishna told him, I am on your side. Fight. Arjuna was victorious because God was on his side. Shyamasundara Das. For Hegel, because the conflict itself is purifying, it has some ethical value. He writes, by war, the ethical health of the nation is preserved, and its finite aims uprooted. Srila Prabhupada, then he wants continuous war? If that is the case, Hitler is a first-class man. But why is he condemned? Of course, in the material world there are opposing elements, and therefore, there must be war. It is not that war can be stopped. Rather, the party that has Krishna's support will emerge victorious. We don't say that you can stop war, but that if you fight, you should fight on behalf of Krishna. Shyamasundara Das. But what of Hegel's view that progress comes only through conflict, and that peace means stagnation? Srila Prabhupada. We do not agree that peace is stagnation. Our peace is working for Krishna. That is real peace. We are educating people to understand that Krishna is our friend, and this is not stagnation. Telling people about Krishna is our peace. Shyamasundar Das, are we not in a state of war with material nature, Maya? Srila Prabhupada, we don't fight with Maya. Those who are under Maya's clutches and who are being kicked by Maya are struggling with Maya. We have nothing to do with Maya. Daivi hiesha gunamai, mama maya duratyaya, mam eva ye prapadyante, mayam etam tarantite. This divine energy of mine, consisting of the three modes of material nature, is difficult to overcome. But those who are surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it. Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, verse 14. If Maya does not disturb us, what is the point of fighting? Shyamasundar Das, Hegel looks on world history as the supreme tribunal, the higher judge of events. History will bear out the worth of an empire and national policy. Srila Prabhupada, we say that whatever empire comes will certainly fall. There is no need to study history to know that. A godless empire will never endure. Hayagriva Das, Hegel considered history and theology to be intrinsic. History is a justification of God and tells the story of man's elevation to God. Without the history of man, God would be alone and lifeless. Since God is not transcendental but is manifest in the world, he depends on human history. Srila Prabhupada, but if God is dependent on human history, how can he be God? God is always independent. Janmadi asya yato nivayat itaratash charteshva abhigya svarat. Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st canto, 1st chapter, verse 1. If he is dependent on anything, he is not God. Hayagriva Das, does the history of man necessarily make any sense? Hegel looked on history as evolutionary. Srila Prabhupada, as soon as there is creation, there is history. This history will continue until the universe is annihilated. We may superficially consider history as existing from the beginning to the end of the universal manifestation, just as we may consider our personal history to extend from our birth to our death. But God is not subjected to such a history. It is not that God is created at a certain point and then annihilated. Since God is eternal, there is no question of history in respect to him. History is for the finite, for things that have a past, present, and future. Since there is no past, present, and future for God, there is no history. You must have a past, present, and future in order to have history. Shyamasundar Das, Hegel believes that the dominant nation in any epoch represents a dominant phase of the absolute at that time. For instance, if the United States is currently predominant, the absolute is being expressed through the United States. Srila Prabhupada, eons ago, the absolute truth was connected to the dominant nation, that is, to Maharaj Parikshit, because Maharaj Parikshit and Maharaj Yudhishthira were representing God. They could dominate the entire world. Now all that is lost, and today there are many small states that are not God-conscious. Therefore, they are fighting each other like cats and dogs. Still, it is a fact that Vedic kings like Maharaj Ramachandra, Maharaj Prithu, Maharaj Yudhishthira, and Maharaj Parikshit were actually representatives of God. In those days, one king ruled the entire world. Therefore, there was no trouble. Shyamasundar Das, could America's dominance in this century be attributed to God's will? Srila Prabhupada, whenever we see some extraordinary power, we should understand that it is derived from God's power. We may therefore say that the predominance of America is due to God's favor. However, if Americans spread Krishna consciousness and make their president Krishna conscious, America will be God's empowered nation. Let the president be Krishna conscious. Why not? Educate the American people to be Krishna conscious and elect a Krishna conscious president. This Krishna consciousness movement is in your hands, and it is up to you to utilize it and become the factual leaders of the world. It was my mission to go to America and educate the Americans in Krishna consciousness, because I knew that if they become Krishna conscious, the whole world will follow. You are young men, and this mission is in your hands. A few communists like Stalin and Lenin formed a big communist party, and now this party is dominating most of the world. It was started simply by a few men. Now many of you young Americans have understood this God-conscious philosophy, and it is up to you to spread this movement. You should not become stagnant thinking, now I have understood Krishna consciousness. Now let me sit down and just chant Hare Krishna. This is not desired. Go spread Krishna consciousness, and in this way glorify your nation. Shyamasundar Das. According to Hegel's aesthetics, beauty is the absolute penetrating the world of the senses. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, Krishna is the most beautiful. Because Krishna is beautiful, even the chirping of a bird is beautiful. Krishna is the reservoir of all pleasure and beauty. Beauty is appreciated in the world because beauty is one of Krishna's qualities. Whatever little beauty we find in this material world is but the perverted reflection of Krishna's beauty. Shyamasundar Das. Hegel feels that art is a combination of spiritual content and sensuous form, and that the artist should try to imbue his material forms with spiritual content. Srila Prabhupada. We agree with that. When we are painting pictures, playing music, or writing books, we are placing Krishna at the center. Shyamasundar Das. Of all the arts, Hegel says, music and poetry are the highest. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, therefore we are writing many books. Vyasadeva has written many great epics in praise of Krishna. Lord Brahma has written Brahma Samhita, Chintamani Prakara Sadmasu. There are many poems in praise of Krishna. Therefore, another name for Krishna is Uttama Shloka, the greatest of poems. He is described in beautiful poetry in the Vedic literatures. It is not very important whether it is poetry or prose. Anything sublime is called poetry. It is not that it has to be written in meter. Shyamasundar Das. For Hegel, religion is pure thought put into form. Srila Prabhupada. He has no knowledge of what religion is. Religion is neither imagination nor pure thought. Religion is the order coming from the most pure. This cannot be imagined or created. We need only receive the instructions from the most pure. These are given in Bhagavad Gita. We are not imagining this. Hayagriva Das. Hegel maintained that since God is necessarily manifest in the infinite, the incarnation is central to any religion. In order for God to be manifest, he has to incarnate as a finite man. Srila Prabhupada. If God becomes a mere man and is to be considered such, why should his instructions be followed? Hayagriva Das. Hegel did not believe in following any exterior will. Srila Prabhupada. This means that he is either godless or that God has no meaning for him. Hayagriva Das. He interpreted the goal of Indian philosophy to be nirvana, spiritual as well as physical extinction. Srila Prabhupada. Everyone acknowledges physical extinction, and as far as the spiritual is concerned, there is no such thing as extinction. The spirit is eternal. Na jayate mriyate va kadachin, nayam bhutva bhavita vana bhuya. Ajo nicha shashvato yam parano, na hanyate hanyamani sharire. For the soul there is never birth nor death, nor having once been does he ever cease to be. He is unborn, eternal, ever-existing, undying, and primeval. He is not slain when the body is slain. Bhagavad Gita, 2nd chapter, verse 20. If the spirit is annihilated, how is it different from matter? Shyamasundar Das. Hegel believed that in the highest religion, God is seen as Father, Son, and all-pervasive Holy Spirit. Thus he considered Christianity to be the perfect religion. Srila Prabhupada. Is it perfect to say that God only has one Son? If God is unlimited, why is he limited to only one Son? Shyamasundar Das. Well, he claims that Christ represents nature, or the objective world, because Christ is God incarnate. Srila Prabhupada. When there is an incarnation of God as the Son of God, and an incarnation of God as God himself, which is superior? If God has begotten a Son, God is a Father, a person. How can a Son be born of an impersonal Father? What evidence do we have of such a thing ever happening? Shyamasundar Das. Hegel would like to have philosophy without religion because he saw religion as basically an encumbrance. Srila Prabhupada. Such a philosophy is simply mental speculation. If he claims that philosophy is superior to religion, then religion supported by philosophy is real religion. Otherwise, it is sentiment. As I stated before, the orders of God constitute religion. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, "Surrender unto me." This is religion. When we try to understand why Krishna wants us to surrender unto him, why we are obliged to surrender unto him, we are in the realm of philosophy. When philosophy supports religion, it is perfect. It is neither sentiment nor mental speculation. High Grivadas. In the Phenomenology of the Spirit, Hegel deprecates the use of plants and animals as objects of religion, considering it a kind of pantheism typical of Hinduism. How would worship of the tulsi plant or the cow differ? Srila Prabhupada. God has specifically said that among plants, he is the tulsi. It is not that the Hindus are worshipping just any plant. For instance, in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, "Pranava sarva vedeshu." I am the syllable Om in the Vedic mantras. Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, verse 8. Therefore, the word Om is used in mantras, as in Om Tad Vishnu Paramam Padam. We know that Omkara is God because God says so. God gives instructions on how he should be realized, and we have only to follow. What is the point in speculating? We can never understand the unlimited God by our limited speculation. Hai Grivadas. But if God is in all animals and in all plants, why concentrate on any particular ones? Why not worship all? Srila Prabhupada. That is especially prohibited. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, "Maya tatam idam sarvam jagad avyakta murtina matstani sarva bhutani nachaham teshva avashtita." By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 4. The soul and the supersoul exist within the body of a dog, but this does not mean that the barking of a dog is the word of God. Vivekananda said that we should worship Daridra, the poor man in the street. He even used the word Daridra Narayan, indicating that Narayan, God, has become poor, Daridra. Although the body of a Daridra rests in God, Narayan, we should not consider his body to be the body of Narayan. Everything in a government may rest on the orders of the king, but the king is not personally present everywhere. According to the Achintya beta-beta philosophy, God is simultaneously one with and different from his creation. God is undoubtedly present in the heart of the Dharidra, the poor man. But we should not consider the Dharidra to be God. That is an impersonalist Mayavadi mistake. That is pantheism. Hayagriva Das. When Lord Krishna says that he is sex life according to Dharma, does that mean he can be perceived in that way? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, if one performs the Garbhadana ceremony to beget a Krishna-conscious child, Krishna is remembered. It is the duty of the father to remember Krishna while having sex, thinking, Krishna, give me a child who will be your devotee. This kind of sex is for Krishna, and is Krishna. But if one has sex for his own sense enjoyment, that is demoniac. Hayagriva Das. But isn't Krishna present nonetheless? Srila Prabhupada. Krishna is always present. But when we hold the Garbhadan ceremony to beget a Krishna-conscious child, we remember Krishna. The rules and regulations for the Garbhadan ceremony are given in the Srimad Bhagavatam. As soon as society abandons this ceremony, people become degraded. Hayagriva Das. So the philosophy behind reverence for the Tulsi plant and the cow, or the sexual ceremony, is that these can bring remembrance of Krishna. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, Krishna says, Satatam kirtayanto mam yat tantash cha dridha vrata namas yantash cha mam bhaktya nitya yukta upasate. Always chanting my glories, endeavoring with great determination, bowing down before me. These great souls perpetually worship me with devotion. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 14. If somehow or other you always think of Krishna, you become Krishna conscious. Hayagriva Das. Is it that you shouldn't think of Krishna in any other way, for instance, as a palm tree? Srila Prabhupada. When Krishna says that among trees he is the Tulsi or whatever, we should simply accept it. For instance, he says, Rasoham Apsu Konteya, I am the taste of water. Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter verse 8. When we follow these instructions, we think, I am drinking water and am feeling satisfaction. This satisfaction is Krishna. In this way, we can remember him. Hayagriva Das. Hegel mistook this for pantheism. Srila Prabhupada. He is mistaken in so many ways.